joining us at the United States Cannabis Conference and Expo in Phoenix, Arizona on Saturday, October 5th. My name is Audrey Kirger, and today we will be talking about cannabis and autism. I got involved in the industry just over 4 years ago. My son Ashton is actually diagnosed autistic, and we saw a tremendous amount of behavioral issues coming from him that were not being managed by any of the therapies that we were utilizing, including ABA therapy, occupational therapy, physical therapy, et cetera. And with that, many of the things that we were dealing with were extremely stressful. And so I started doing my own research and found that I had confidence in trying a cannabinoid therapy. And from there, we have utilized cannabinoid therapy since 2016 from a company that has provided an amazing product for us. And so now with our son, we just see a whole new world. Today, we have two panelists to discuss this topic with us. Liz Valentine with Green Star Doctors and Brandy Williams with Arizona Mamas. And I'm going to turn it over to them to allow them to introduce themselves more.
Liz Valentine, and I started Green Star Doctors 7 years ago with the intention to help patients, and I feel that I do that. It's not much to say except that I love the way cannabis treats people, and every year I see that there's benefits and that they're getting better. So we're talking about autism, and there's a lot of children that come through, and I look forward to speaking about this.
Brandy? My name is Brandy Williams. I'm mother to Logan Simpson. My son gained legal access in 2015, and from there I joined a grassroots national organization called MAMA, Mothers Advocating Medical Marijuana for Autism. I am currently the Arizona State Director and also on the board of directors. I am a petition specialist and a research specialist. Logan was banging his head 75 to 150 times per day and was completely nonverbal. His sensory issues were so bad that he would literally rip clothes off of his body. We could not go into public. My son was so severe we had to homeschool him for kindergarten and first grade. Today, Logan is a healthy, happy little 8-year-old boy. He goes to school full time. Within the first 20 minutes of his first dose, I saw cannabis help my son. Within the first 2 months, he added 180 words to his vocabulary. And today he goes to school full time, and he knows how to read, and he is potty trained now, so. So basically none of us are doctors. We're just here to promote and inform consumers. So don't take our word for it, do your own research.
So let's discuss what is autism. There are a lot of different things that could qualify as autism. And what we see here with the DSM-5 is a social, communication, and behavioral topics that we can look for in children to see how they are acting and interacting with typical children to see if they do fall within this category. There are also many levels of the autism spectrum disorder, and we can look at a wide variety of different ailments or diagnoses that can create the characteristics of autism in children as well as adults. As you can see here, Brandy is going to explain a little bit more in detail about autistic disorder.
So it is a spectrum. There are very high functioning people on the spectrum, and it can go to very severe, and they need a very high quality of health. Not only do they have social and emotional and behavioral and educational deficits, they also have a lot of comorbid conditions that were being ignored up until the last decade. A lot of times, the professionals were telling us parents, you know, they're not speaking and they have aggression because they can't speak. Well, what they were starting to realize is there's a lot of medical comorbid conditions that need to be addressed. Next slide. Most commonly, gastrointestinal disturbances, enterocolitis, Crohn's, seizure disorder, and also immune deficiencies. So, you know, there's plenty of studies to show the core morbidity of autism. Those three things aren't the only thing. This was extracted from a recent study, mood disorders. I mean, the list just keeps going. Additional comorbidity. My son actually had over 26 comorbid conditions with his autism. You know, a lot of us parents are just, you know, that's autism, that's all you can do, let's do some therapy. And a lot of kids need beyond just that.
So one of the things that we realized while there were so many reasons why the parents were struggling getting qualified and certified is that we weren't really, the organization of certification clinics may not be asking all the right questions. If somebody just says they have autism and it's not on the list, it shouldn't be ruled out as unacceptable qualifying conditions. There are so many ways to break down. If you go back to the last slide, I just want to go over it. Some of these are really good qualifying conditions that are black and white. And with Green Star, we've tried to be human first and look past just the limitation of where the law tells us who qualifies. If you look at the parent and they're struggling with their child, we have to be a lot more sensitive to the fact that they don't have other choices. All the other choices are causing so many side effects. So cannabis is really their choice. Parents coming in shouldn't be so second-guessed. So
the statistics are climbing. It's now 1 in 59. Kids are diagnosed with autism. I kind of wanted to get an idea and see if anybody here has a loved one with autism. A lot of people on the spectrum, you know, they live with their parents for the rest of their lives, over 87%. I think we could do a lot better.
So I'd like to ask you, what currently do parents have a choice for, not only for their children, but for themselves? There's so much stress involved. I know during our struggles, I had a lot of family members who didn't understand my choices of not seeking pharmaceutical care and versus going to a more homeopathic way. I know that there are medications out there. We were prescribed a medication, and so were a lot of the other families that I know that are struggling with this. What are some of the things that we have currently available to us on both sides of the coin?
So typically the standard of care is, you know, there's no medications to treat the core symptoms of autism. There's only antipsychotics to treat the irritability associated with autism. They also recommend ABA therapy. And what that is it's, they do a series of tasks repetitively over and over and over again. So it becomes an automatic response. And by doing that, they actually burn neural pathways in the brain by doing that repetition. So they recommend therapy, and the only other medication that they really have to offer us is antipsychotics. The antipsychotics come with a heavy, heavy list of side effects, one of them being male breast growth. It actually increases in aggression. One of the top reported adverse effects is diabetes. third most reported is death. That's enough to give a lot of parents pause, but they're in such distress that they don't have a lot of options, and the doctors do not have a whole lot of tools in the toolbox to utilize. One of the things that made me, totally deterred me from using antipsychotic products with my son was the fact that Risperdal actually physically shrinks the brain mass. So, you know, a lot of the pushback we get as parents is, oh, cannabis lowers the IQ points. Well, we could let our kids continue to bang their heads and get brain injuries, give them the antipsychotics that are physically going to shrink their brain mass, or give them cannabis, which actually doesn't decrease the brain IQ. It actually helps the brain. So, you know, those are some of the adverse effects of the drugs. It's very scary to think about. Next slide. So a lot of us parents just want to be able to assess risk versus benefit. You know, a lot of doctors take their oath to do no harm, and we need to do a little better job at educating people, and hopefully, you know, doctors will have more tools in the toolbox to utilize in the future.
So how does cannabis help the ASD patient population, and is this safe for developing brains? Liz, you're working in a medical practice, Green Star Doctors. You're helping to educate people on this topic on a daily basis. Is this safe for human consumption? How have we seen this change and be more accepted?
Absolutely. You can just tell in the children that are struggling with behavior and that they're much calmer and they're not hurting themselves. That's a huge benefit right there. Even if there's going to be naysayers, and what we see as a community is very positive. There's too many of us saying the accounts are going well versus adversely. These side effects are not toxic or lethal. And it seems to be working, right? We're seeing so many people come back with positive. Now, there are definitely a few people who are not finding the benefit because their trial and error is more difficult, and it does require a lot more tenacity than allopathic, just a prescription, go fill it, and those tend to not work anyway. So the trial and error is something that with cannabis, we each have different pathologies, the plant has different pathologies, the deliveries are all different. If we find the right pathway, then we could have the healings involved.
Wonderful. So I know that there's been a lot of discussion around anandamide and also 2-AG, which are both internal cannabinoids that our body is creating. And we're seeing that in recent studies, anandamide is not prevalent or being created within the human mind body of the individuals that are diagnosed with autism. Yeah. Can we talk a little bit about how the phytocannabinoids from the plant are helping to replenish that and balance the children?
So there is a ton of studies out there that are showing kids on the spectrum are not creating anandamide. And like Audrey said, that's an endocannabinoid that you and I are pretty much naturally creating in our bodies. Next slide. There's even actually a patent on how to show the severity of autism based on the endocannabinoid deficiency. If you don't know, anandamide is literally a neurotransmitter. And like we were discussing before, doing the ABA, having to do repetition to burn those neural pathways, well, cannabis is doing that naturally.
You're hungry.
So we just went in briefly about, you know, endogenous cannabinoids versus phytocannabinoids. Our kids are not creating anandamide. So they need to be supplemented with phytocannabinoids from the plant. You know, there is receptors throughout the whole entire body. In my opinion, and cannabinoids antagonizing CB1 and CB2 receptors are very desirable because a lot of that modulation from the the endocannabinoid system, that's where you're gonna get that is by antagonizing CB1 and CB2. So what does the endocannabinoid system regulate? Pretty much everything that's dysregulated in our kids with autism. You know, memory, cognition, sleep, appetite, mood, fear, attention, reproduction, immune function, movement disorders. Those are really common in our community. If you see kids flapping their heads, jumping up and down, rocking back and forth, that's actually modulated by the endocannabinoid system. So, and also pain. Our body's perception of pain, it's called nociception. It's either denuded or very intense. That's why a lot of kids harm themselves. So aggression, over 50% of the autism community experiences aggression or self-injury behavior at some point.
And Liz, did you want to add into how Green Star doctors and other cannabis professionals across the nation are helping with these comorbid disorders and how we're able to look past just the diagnosis of autism and look a little bit deeper into the individual and be able to help them within the state of Arizona, specifically because they do not allow autism to be a qualifying condition for a cannabis medical card?
Absolutely. Comorbid conditions are going to qualify an autism patient. There are several ways to get qualified, and chronic pain is various. It doesn't have to just be lower back pain. There are so many reasons why you will qualify. Hopefully other professionals will ask more questions to get to that answer. And we certainly do. We believe that everyone is qualified, and quite often the people who are speaking for themselves don't even know how they qualify. So oftentimes they don't actually say what is going on with themselves right away, and we find out little by little what will qualify them. And that's what we do. We go that extra step. We try to help the parent. When you see someone struggling, how can we just turn the blind eye and deaf ear and say, well, you know, in black and white, it's not available? It is, and we just have to dig a little deeper.
Wonderful. So I have read multiple studies about the endocannabinoid system being supplemented and fed with phytocannabinoids and neurogenesis happening. Can we discuss a little bit more about why neurogenesis is so important in an autistic individual and why cannabis would support that?
Well, essentially, you know, neurogenesis, well, so, you know, when our kids are banging their heads and things, you know, things, brain cells die off. There's excitotoxins in their environment. They need cell regeneration. And when their bodies are not creating endodamine, it needs to be supplemented. That's why it's so important. We need to push forward with advocacy and make changes to the law to include autism. So studies plus advocacy equals hope for all those parents out there. I know parents with kids that have 20-year-old autistic children, 30-year-old autistic children that have been waiting for a very long time for something to help them. There are studies being done all over the world right now. The Chilean study came out this last fall. Next slide. There's some data extracted from that. Next slide. Then the Israel study, they came out with their preliminary findings this April, which is really gonna help us in the advocacy world. Next slide. There's been mention in Australia. Next one, you can kind of randomly go through these. That one, so the Department of Defense actually just allocated $1.3 million to cannabis and autism research. And I was speaking to a senator here, and he asked me, well, why would the Department of Defense actually allocate funds to this? And next slide. We actually found some commentary, next one, from the director of Montefiore, who actually received that grant funding, that the military is actually having a hard time deploying families across the country. When you have a family member with autism, you can't just up and move and expect to get services for these families. So the military is actually having a hard time deploying people around the country, so they've actually become involved. There's a lot of studies going on right now and on cannabis and autism. You know, 3 years ago, my prediction was that, you know, with the rates of autism being as high as they are, the lack of care that's available, once parents get a hold of this information, it's gonna blow up. And it has, in a big way in our community.
Yeah.
So again, my group, Mamas, our parent advocates have been working very, very hard to change the laws across the state. Next slide. We've been successful at adding autism as a qualifying condition in Pennsylvania, Delaware, Georgia, Minnesota, Louisiana, and Michigan in less than 2 years. Until then, you know, the laws are being changed at a snail's pace. What can we do for this patient population now? And that's something that our community here in Arizona has turned the lids for. A lot of times, these evaluation centers, they're like, they hear the word autism and they automatically turn the parents away. And these parents just feel like they can't get their kid qualified, when in reality, their kid has over 4 different comorbid conditions that will qualify.
And Liz, can you discuss some of the things that you would consult with your clients on to figure out how they would be able to qualify? And maybe that will be able to educate some of our other clinics as well to be able to look deeper into their patients.
We just ask these questions so that we can find out a little bit more about each patient. So everyone is very different, but they all qualify. If there is digestive, if there's self-inflicting pain, if there's nausea, it varies so much what a patient goes through.
Ticks. I could go under muscles.
Yes, there are lists and lists of reasons, and I really do believe that the clinics that are not taking that extra step are scared. I don't know why. I believe that autism is spooky. It's happening to children. It's mortifying people, and they don't know how to handle it. Much the way we look at the elderly community with dementia or Alzheimer's, we have so much sympathy for our elderly, and we're lacking some of the same sympathy that is very similar in the tics and the antics that would go into the brain having its issues. So, you know, hopefully clinics can do a little bit better of a job just assessing what each human condition is going on, not just the one or the overall. It's not a 5-minute conversation, it's 30 minutes at the least.
Yeah, these kids have really extensive medical comorbidities that, you know, they were being overlooked for many, many years. We're very, the parents are very happy that the medical industry is actually trying to catch up to where us parents are. A lot of us parents never believed that our kids were smashing their heads on brick walls because they couldn't, because they were frustrated. Like, a lot of us parents know our kids intuitively, instinctively, even if our kids are nonverbal, just their nonverbal cues can tell us a lot about what these kids are going through. So, you know, with the head banging, those are the kids we really want to get to because they can cause further damage to themselves. Concussions, post-concussion syndrome, traumatic brain injury are all very serious. There's very serious side effects and consequences from banging your head. I personally watched my son head bang a brick wall and head bang the concrete floor. And I was terrified. When I took him to the hospital, they literally could do nothing for him. And when we got home, we gave him an extra dose of THC. And I knew that THC has neuroprotective properties, and it's going to reduce that inflammation from him just bludging his head on a brick wall. So, you know, some of the pushback that we get is that it actually kills the brain cells. And I'm sure a lot of people in this room know where that propagated from. That propaganda came from, you know, the Reagan era, when they took a bunch of Reese's monkeys and were smoked into their, through a mask, and it actually suffocated them. That is where the whole, you know, losing brain cells came from. And that stigma is very much still alive in our community with autism. So for the last 4 years, I've done my best to try to bridge the cannabis and the autism community together so they can learn from each other. And one of the things that I like to tell parents is that the endocannabinoid system is different in every single person. If you try one product and it doesn't work, that doesn't mean cannabis won't work for you. You just have to find the sweet spot. And it's very hard. Parents want to give up. It's stressful. It's expensive, very expensive. We were spending about $1,200 a month on cannabis for my son. If it did not work, I would not be paying that much. I've literally pawned almost everything of value just to get my son what he needs, because it's done that much for him. Definitely want to encourage parents not to give up, to find that, you know, whatever works for Johnny is not going to work for your kid. So not to give up and to trial and error. Best thing to do is take a sheet of paper and write down every single little thing, so that way you can chart and find what's working and what's not.
Those are really great tips, Brandy. And we do have a pretty nice audience in here. And so what I'd like to do now is offer for anyone in our audience to ask any questions that they might have for myself and, of course, both of the panelists.
Good morning, ladies. Thank you so much for sharing your story. I guess I would like to know, because I have a grandchild that has seizures, and I would like to know some, and I know every child is different, but you kind of have to, could you tell us some ballpark figures on dosage, on how you administer, on, and let's stay with the milligrams per kilogram, that's fine, because that gives us an area that, but dosing, can you help me out with dosing?
So dosing for me was very difficult. I am not good at math at all, so like double milligram amounts didn't make sense to me when you have different ratios of cannabinoids, so I completely dumped all of that. And I started low and slow. I started with a flower strain that was high in CBD, low in THC. That didn't work. I went up in THC. And I just gave him little micro doses. And I kind of pushed the threshold to see where his threshold was, because I wanted to make him comfortable but not too medicated.
And how did you dose flower?
So we don't use flower. We use other options, and since there's like
there's a multitude of ways to find products.
Yeah, there are so many different ways. You can encapsulate flower, you can do tinctures, you can do oil infusions, you can do full extractions, you can do isolates. Isolates, I don't know too many people in our community that has found success with isolates only. It seems
that would be like CBD products?
CBD only, or
an isolated cannabinoid.
Yes, CBG only. It seems like the bulk of the community that's seeing the most success, they're using a spectrum of cannabinoids and terpenes. Terpenes are very important.
And when you say a spectrum of CBD, THC, and terpenes, all
together, all extracted from the plant matter. Yep.
And if I can add in, because I have gone through this same exact journey. What I actually started with was utilizing only 10 milligrams of what I consider a full spectrum CBD rich product. So again, it has what is considered at this time federally legal, because my child is not under the medical marijuana program in the state of Arizona. I didn't think that it was a need until I got to that point, and we never got to that point for my family. I was able to utilize a full spectrum. So I've had my products tested. I highly recommend these things are not required. A certificate of analysis is not required, so take your medicine to someone that you trust to have it tested. I've tested for solvents, terpene profiles, cannabinoid profiles. Heavy metal profiles are very expensive, and there's not a lot of labs that do it. But for my family, again, we started at 10 milligrams of the CBD-rich product that had also THC at that 0.3% or less. And with that, we were able to continue increasing his supplement. And my son takes about 125 milligrams of CBD-rich product every single day.
And how much THC?
Whatever the 0.3% is.
It's
whatever is naturally occurring.
They wouldn't be able to ship it. So
whatever's naturally occurring in the plant, that is the 0.3% federal. And for us, it's just been a miracle. Like I said, we started at that 10 milligrams, and as we stepped up, we started to see more and more of a positive reaction. And so for myself, I didn't need to go get a medical card because I found a good product. But I will say, it took a lot of trial and error. I used about 30 different products from around the state of Arizona. None of them worked. There was nobody really to guide me.
If you try to listen to what everybody else is having going on, you're going to drive yourself crazy.
It's going to be your own experience.
Listen to your child. Listen to your grandchild. Let them and their nonverbal cues tell you and direct you where you need to go. Yeah, absolutely.
And there's no overdosing on CBD. THC, you can take too much. There's a really great product that's available here in the state of Arizona called Undo that you can actually pop the gel cap and utilize that if you saw an adverse side effect in your child, and it does work very well.
Yes, it does.
So that is something also. And I personally believe THC is more of a nighttime thing for a child, and CBD is more of a daytime thing for my children. And so for us, if we have ever utilized a high THC product as a test, we've utilized it at night, but we've never seen any positive benefit more than what we received, so we just didn't follow that route. But there are so many doctors out there willing to help, I believe, through our care clinics. There are doctors in there. You just need to call and talk to the administration that is working within those offices to find out who's going to be able to support you, like Green Star Doctors. You know, there's multiple other doctors that are working with people.
So my experience and a lot of other people that are in MAMAs, we're having a hard time finding doctors that will help you with dosing. So it really truly is up to the parents.
Think about this with the
pharmaceutical drugs, who do the doctors depend on to observe and report? It's the parents' observation. Same thing with this. Same thing with cannabis. When their pharmaceutical drugs aren't working, what do? They up the dose. That's the same thing that we need to do with the cannabis. And a lot of pushback that we get is, how are these dumb parents ever going to know how to dose their kids with cannabis? Well, it's observe and report, just like the pharmaceuticals. So.
Is there any other questions?
Yes, I have a question. This has been an excellent presentation. I've had a little problem reading your PowerPoint. Is your PowerPoint available online, or can I get a hard copy?
The U.S. Cannabis Conference will be providing that. This document will be provided to them for them to be able to distribute.
Thank you. Our granddaughter's in California, and I wanted to send the whole thing over to them.
Wonderful.
They'll have access in California. It's up to the doctor's discretion in California, so they'll have a much easier time there.
It's convincing the parents is what I want
to say. Oh, yeah. I mean,
They're a little bit in denial. She's in the autism spectrum, but she's not autistic. She's dyspraxic.
Oh, yeah, dyspraxic and apraxia. That's all has to do with neurocommunication in the brain. And so the fact that cannabis is actually, creates neurotransmission would help them, create those pathways naturally just by, utilizing cannabis.
Very good. Thank you.
I see there's another question in the audience.
Yes, one of my friends, he just got diagnosed with skipping autistic, and he does a lot of the headbanging stuff. What's the best age to start implementing?
What's the best age to what?
To start implementing. CBDs or THC into her system?
Now.
At that age.
Now. Your body, when you become pregnant, has a fetus at 16 days gestation that has a fully functioning endocannabinoid system. This is from conception to death. If our animals were utilizing cannabinoids like they used to, because hemp was livestock food, we would not have these types of issues with removing a lot of the other toxicities from the outside. So,
can I back off of that?
Oh yeah, so utilizing cannabinoids is perfect starting from any age.
So one of the theories in our this medical think tank, the scientific think tank that we're a part of, is that prohibition could actually be in part responsible for the autism epidemic. We have had cannabinoids in our food, in our livestock, and so forth for about 100 years now. And if you look at the autism rates over the last 100 years, autism wasn't heard of 100 years ago. It was first documented by Leo Kanner in 1932 as a condition remarkably different, unlike any other. So it's kind of weird how prohibition and this autism rates and increase over these generations just keeps going up. So,
any other questions from our audience members today concerning cannabis and autism?
I guess.
Okay.
How do you know, the purity of what you're going to administer to a child, the testing labs? What's the best way to find out, a place that'll do the testing with accurate results? Because, it's kind of the Wild West out there, just going to a dispensary and getting something.
You want to know.
Yeah, exactly. But, the products, I see so much variability in that. You guys have any suggestions on
There's multiple cannabis testing laboratories around the state of Arizona. You will need to go online and do some research. Call them, book an appointment, go speak with the people who are managing or owning the company. Find out who you feel confident with and utilize their facility for your testing. I personally know in the industry that you can pay off someone to have a lab result look a certain way, so I never trust anybody's lab result coming from them personally. I think it's something that we as a utilizer of a product should need to do for ourselves at this time. And hopefully in the future it'll be federally mandated and labs will have to be ISO accredited. And that is something else that you will want to look into, an ISO accredited laboratory or someone that's very close to that accreditation as well.
Yeah, and I mean, when you're dealing with a pediatric population, testing is a very good idea. When you find a strain that works, you might not have access to that strain forever. So knowing that unique terpene profile and cannabinoid profile will help you pick future strains as well. So it's very important.
And that is another thing. If you are going to utilize a dispensary for getting your medicine once you have a medical card, I would definitely have a consultation with a high-level management or ownership to let them know that you will be treating a child and that you will be going through this learning process or phase. And once you do find a strain that works for you, they need to continue to carry that for you. One of the things I found on a different client that is not autistic that does have a medical card, she found a really great strain. Well, guess what? They had it for 90 days, and I've been asking for it for 2 years, and they still do not carry it. So having that communication, like, I am a parent servicing a child. This is not a recreational fun time thing. I need, when we find the medicine that's going to work for our baby, for you to continue to carry that for me so I can give it to them. I know that's something that Brandy's dealt with as well. So that is something that I also highly encourage every individual who is going to go into the medical side of this to really look into.
Yeah, my son's very strain specific and it drives me crazy. We wouldn't be here today if it weren't for cannabis. We had 40 hours of rehabilitation, speech, occupational therapy, music therapy, hypotherapy. We had over 57 hours of therapy every week and for many years, for 5 years straight, and we felt like we absolutely got nowhere. And literally within 20 minutes of my son's first dose, his whole demeanor, his attitude, the light in his eyes was completely different in less than 20 minutes. And cannabis has been the best intervention we have ever tried. And we have sunk thousands of dollars into interventions.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions from our audience?
I know I've been hearing all the benefits of it, but is there any adverse reactions to CBD for children?
There could be. It could cause agitation in autism. And a lot of things that we see in the community is like, we'll start a kid off on a regimen, and in 2 months, they hit, it's like the honeymoon is over. And it's not necessary that it's not helping them. Cannabis and the constituents of cannabis actually have antimicrobial, properties. These kids have a lot of their immune systems, we were talking about their immune systems being impaired. They cannot kill off pathogens and viral loads like you and I can. So when you're giving them the cannabis and it has those properties and they experience die-off symptoms, it's called a Herxheimer reaction. So it's not that it's actually causing them to lose it, because it's not. They're literally having a die-off symptoms, which is a good thing. So I would definitely
looked at by a lot of people. Yes. Oh my goodness, I need to stop. So
when you are going to see a bad reaction, you'll see it from day one, not 2 months later.
And I have had
a wall that they reach. Like for me personally, like if I smoke enough or whatever, I'm at a plateau where I don't get that much higher.
Building a tolerance. Yes, absolutely. When those receptors are oversaturated or saturated with the same profiles, it tends to not have the same effect. What we do, we're actually experiencing this right now, even though my son is very strain specific, he does build up a tolerance, and we just switch up the strains for a couple days to a week, and then go back to the strains that work the best for him. They don't work as well, but all cannabis works at some degree. So there's just some strains work better than others.
And you can also look at a child, like when they do start a cannabinoid regimen and they're going through this therapeutic process, their body is trying to become what is called homeostatic. And homeostasis is the balance of your inner environment with all the other things that are going on in disruptions. So when I'm working with an autistic child specifically, I will look at what they are consuming, because you are what you eat. What they are drinking, how they're utilizing, bowel movements and toileting, because these things are going to give you signs as a parent or a caregiver to an autistic child of what's going on with their body. And we do see that there is a detoxification or a purification process that goes on within the body. There are multiple different supplements that will help clean out glyphosate from the body, actually, which is something that we do know is a neurotoxin, which can also be exciting these autistic behaviors and symptoms. So working with someone that is, holistic in their coaching methods is also very advantageous when working with an individual that has autism, because you could be washing your child in Johnson & Johnson baby wash, which is very cheap, and I know we are not all rich, but there is something here in the United States that is not followed like other countries. Half of Johnson & Johnson products are filled with formaldehyde, unlike if you go to Europe, that was banned 20, 30 years ago. So you don't even know if the laundry detergent is causing some of those adverse effects for your child's symptoms. So looking at the whole person and utilizing the cannabis to balance them is very good. And then as you add in those other homeopathic remedies and work places for your home, you'll see an even better result.
And usually when you're addressing autism with biomedical protocols, you want to do one protocol at a time, so that way you know what's working and what's not, and you have a better idea. And for any parent that's trying to improve the quality of their loved one's life, documentation is going to be your best friend.
And don't give up.
Yes, never
don't
give up.
Cannabis is a cure-all.
Yes. Any other questions from our audience this morning?
No, you answered mine. It was a drug protocol, so you back off the drug protocol and increase the cannabis protocol.
So if you're using pharmaceutical drugs, you definitely cannot stop. Don't stop right away without a doctor helping you wean off those drugs. A lot of times that kids have to slow, low and slow always, because there's a lot of problems with that. You can't just stop them. A lot of kids, you have to dose your cannabis and your pharmaceuticals within like 2 hours of each other.
And I've actually heard 4 hours due to metabolization is best if you can utilize prescription medications in a space of your cannabis of 4 hours difference.
So you will need a doctor to help you wean from those safely.
Any other questions? We have hit the end of our time, so I just want to make sure everyone feels that they've gotten the information that they needed. I will let you know that Brandy does have a booth downstairs, so does Liz. Liz does not, so come up and get her number. I apologize. But Brandy does, back in the kids area, so if you do have friends with children, they are free. Call them, let them know to come to the conference today. They can play on the bounce houses that are provided. They can get educated by Brandy, and I also have a booth downstairs, so please come and talk to us. We're here to help support you and the families that you know that are struggling with this. And